Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, a very good evening to all of you, and good morning to some of the dear brethren all around the world. I hope my audio is very clear and you're able to see the PowerPoint as well. First of all, I would like to bring loving greetings of the dear brethren from Bangalore, Mangalore, Mysore, Davangere, Hunsur, Goa, Bagalkote, and Hubli, and various other places from India. I thank our Lord for giving me the opportunity to serve his flock, and also the Convention Committee brethren for giving me an opportunity to serve the brethren. Today, we are going to concentrate on the topic glorification of the church, portrayed in the closing experiences of Prophet Elijah, the details of which is given to us in 2 Kings chapter 2. We read in verse 1 that it came to pass when the Lord would take up Elijah into heaven by a whirlwind. So this verse clearly tells that this entire chapter deals with the events taking place while Elijah was taken up. We all know that Elijah was not taken to heaven, for our Lord clearly told in John 3:13 that no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man. The Spirit of God many a times was translating Elijah from one place to other. And even here, Elijah was translated to a valley or a mountain and died, he being buried by God, whose whereabouts is not revealed to us. As given in 2 Kings, 2nd chapter, verses 1 to 3, Elijah began his journey from Gilgal to Bethel. And Elijah said unto Elisha to stay in Gilgal, as God had told him to go to Bethel. But Elisha was so attached to Elijah after so many years of service with him, he had built a bondage with him and would not leave Elijah. So they both went together from Gilgal to Bethel. As mentioned in verse 3, when they were at Bethel, the sons of God came forth to Elisha and said unto him, knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? And he said, yeah, I know it. Hold your peace. So who are these sons of prophets? After the victory at Mount Carmel, the children of Israel had decided to worship the one true God. To develop such people in the Lord, the school of prophets were organized all around Israel, and one such school was at Bethel. The news of Elijah being taken away was widespread among the prophets, and the thoughts of losing Elijah had made Elisha sorrowful. And he didn't want anyone to remind him again and again of his loss. Hence, he told the prophets to remain silent. Was Elijah taken up at Bethel? No. For the Lord had told Elijah to come to Jericho. See verse 4 in 2 Kings second chapter. And Elijah said unto him, Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho. And he said, as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they came to Jericho. Now, did the Lord take up Elijah at Jericho? No. For the Lord told Elijah to travel further to Jordan. See verse 6. And Elijah said unto him, tarry, I pray thee, here, for the Lord hath sent me to Jordan. And he said, as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. And they too went on. Did the Lord take up Elijah at Jordan? No, not yet. But yet all knew that Elijah was shortly to be taken up. Hence, the 50 of the sons of prophets stood near Jordan to watch what would happen to Elijah. See verse 7. And 50 men of the sons of prophets went and stood to view afar off, and they too stood by Jordan. Now let us read 2 Kings, 2nd chapter, verse 8 and 9. And Elijah took his mantle, wrapped it together, and smote the waters, and they were divided hither and thither. So they too went over on dry ground. And it came to pass, when they were gone over, that Elijah said unto Elisha, ask what I shall do for thee before I be taken away from thee. And Elisha said, I pray thee, let a double portion of thy spirit be upon me. Elisha was so much impressed by the zeal of Elijah that he desired to be like him and do similar work as God's chosen servant. Hence, Elijah requested a double portion of the spirit of Elijah. This clearly shows that Elisha lacked something which Elijah had. Now, what was the reply of Elijah? Verse 10 says, thou hast asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, if thou see me when I am taken from thee, it shall be so unto thee. But if not, it shall not be so. Elisha was to receive double portion of the spirit of Elijah, but only on a condition. And that condition was to see Elijah being taken up. Now let us read verse 11. And it came to pass, as they still went on and talked, that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire and horses of fire, and parted them asunder. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. As they both went on and continued to walk, crossing Jordan, suddenly both were separated. How were they separated? Chariot of fire, horses of fire separated them. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind. Seeing this, Elijah taken up, Elisha cried, my father, the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof. And he took hold of his own clothes and rent them into two pieces. Verse 12. Then Elijah continued to do the same work of Elijah. Verse 14 says, he took the mantle of Elijah that fell from him and smote the waters. They parted hither and thither, and Elisha went over. Dear brethren, the same work of smiting Jordan was done by Elisha. Seeing this, the sons of prophets recognized the double portion of the spirit of Elijah rested on Elisha. Verse 15. Hence we see that Elijah performed 8 miracles while Elisha performed 16 miracles, double to that of Elijah. At last, the sons of prophets, thinking that Elijah might have been cast upon some mountain or in a valley, urged Elisha to send to search for him. But Elisha did not agree. But after much compulsion, Elisha agreed to send them to search. After 3 days of search, they could not find Elijah and returned back to Elisha. We can read that one in verse 16 to 18. Next, from verses 19 to 22, we read about the first miracle Elisha did, the healing of the waters of Jericho. So, dear brethren, this is the story that is mentioned in 2 Kings. So, what lesson we have here? The lesson is given in verse 1. It says, it came to pass when the Lord would take up Elijah into heaven by a whirlwind. So the lesson here is about what the Lord would do when Elijah would be taken up in a whirlwind. That is the lesson to us here. Then who does Elijah represent? Who does Elisha represent? What is the meaning of Gilgal? What is the meaning of Bethel? What is the meaning of Jericho? What is the meaning of fiery chariots? What is the meaning of smiting of Jordan? What is the meaning of taken up in a whirlwind? What is the meaning of Elisha taking up the work of Elijah? Dear brethren, what does Elijah represent? Who does Elijah represent? Elijah represents the church, the little flock. See, James 5th chapter, verse 17. It says, Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are. And he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are. Here, Elijah is compared to the church. If Elijah is compared to the church, then all the things that happened during Elijah's life should also have a typical meaning. There has to be an Ahab, a Jezebel, and there has to be a companion, Elijah. That is Elisha. Do we see this comparison in the New Testament? Yes. We read in Revelation chapter 2, verse 20. It says, notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee. Here, thee means the Thyatira church, as mentioned in verse 18. Because though, that is the church, suffers that to man Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. This verse clearly shows that if Elijah represents the church, the little flock, then Jezebel represents the false church. Jezebel was the one who controlled all the religious activity of those days. Similarly, the spiritual affairs of all Christians was under the supervision of the false church, the Great Babylon, whose head is represented by the papacy system, while the body is represented by the entire 750 Protestant denomination. Then, who does Ahab, the king of Israel, represent? While Jezebel controlled all the religious affairs, the political affairs was under Ahab. Yet, Jezebel was influencing Ahab to take decisions. So Ahab here represents the political powers of this world who are under the influence of Babylon. It was under Jezebel's instruction that Ahab began to persecute Elijah. While there was no rain for 3.5 years, in fear, he had to hide in the brook Cherith, where the ravens came and fed him. Similarly, the false church joined hands with the political powers of this world to persecute the true church for a symbolic period of 3.5 years, or else 1260 years during the Dark Ages. We can see that one in Revelation chapter 12, verse 5 and 6. And she brought forth a man child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up unto God and to his throne, and the woman fled into the wilderness, where she had a place prepared of God, that they should feed her there 1,260 days. During this period, there was a great famine of the word of God. The church fled into the wilderness. Condition of less prominence and hid from the society. As the ravens fed Elijah with bread and water daily, similarly, the church was nourished by the two wings of the great eagle. In Revelation 12:14, we read, and to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place, where she is nourished for a time, times and a half a time, from the face of the serpent. Eagle represents God's attributes of wisdom, and its two wings represents the two portion of his word, the Bible, namely Old Testament, the New Testament. It was the word of God that sustained the true church during the Dark Ages. As Elisha returned after 3.5 years to turn the hearts of Israel towards God, and there was a great rain. Similarly, at the end of the Dark Ages, in 1799, there was a great flood of knowledge of enlightenment, awakening. Bible societies were opened. The Bible was translated, printed in all languages, and freely distributed. Soon the work of great conversion of Elijah had begun to turn the hearts of the father to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, thus to make ready a people prepared for the Lord's second coming at 1874. Malachi 4th chapter verse 6, Luke chapter 1 verse 17. Even after the great victory at Mount Carmel, as mentioned in 1 Kings chapter 18, Elijah fled and requested the Lord to end his life, and he slept. You can read that one in 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 4 and 5. He sat down under a juniper tree and requested for himself that he might die, and said, "It is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my father." As he lay and slept under a juniper tree, soon the church expected to be complete. And end of its work, it began to sleep, as mentioned in the parable of the 10 virgins. Matthew chapter 25, verse 5. The bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept, forgetting that its work was not yet completed, as foretold by our Lord in Matthew 10:23. But when they persecute you in this city, flee you into another. For verily I say unto you, you shall not have gone over the cities of Israel till the Son of Man be come in. The glorification of the church was not yet to happen as expected, but the Lord had his own plan, for the vision is yet for an appointed time. But at the end, it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 3. Then what did the Lord do? Did he end Elijah's life? How did he leave Elijah to have his own way? No. See what the Lord did in verse 5 to 7. And as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, "Arise and eat." And he looked, and behold, there was a cake bacon on the coals, and the cruse of water at his head. And he did eat and drink, and laid him down again. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him and said, "Arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee." And he arose and did eat and drink, and went in the strength of that meat 40 days, 40 nights, unto Horeb, the mount of God. The Lord sent angels twice to wake up Elijah. The first angel came and woke him, fed him, but he slept again. While the second angel came, woke him, fed him, he ate and drank, getting strength to continue his journey. The first angel here represents the awakening by the Miller's movement. But still many slept. The second angel represents the ministry of Brother Charles Taze Russell, through whom God gave the meat in due season, the strong meat, which strengthened the church to continue his journey till the end of its course, even to its final glorification. It was as the Lord promised in Revelation 3:20, that behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. And again in Luke chapter 12, verse 36-37. And you yourself, like unto men that wait for the Lord, when he will return from the wedding, that when he cometh and knocketh, ye may open unto him immediately. Blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find so watching. Verily I say unto you, that he shall gird himself and make him to sit down to meat, and will come forth and serve them. Here again, dear brethren, while studying the antitypical meaning, we are not going to compare the different places where Elijah traveled to any dates. Rather, we are going to stick on as we have done till now, comparing these to the conditions or the stages of the church's development as it progresses. Like, for example, in the tabernacle, we have the court, then we have the holy, then we have the most holy. All this represents the conditions and the progress and the development of the church from the believing stage to the consecrated stage, and from there to his glorification in the first resurrection. We humble ourselves as unprofitable servants, students of prophecy, rather than becoming prophets and speculate on dates, be it rather the closing of the door or anything else. We will try to help the brethren and uphold them in truth and in love of the truth, edifying them to make the calling in election sure, rather causing unnecessary fear, agitation by suggesting unscriptural dates for the completion of the church. Elisha traveled with Elijah wherever he went and was to later continue the work of Elijah. See 1 Kings 19:16. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat of Abel-Melo, shall thou anoint to be prophet in thy room. Elisha means the salvation of God. This companion of Elijah represents the great multitude who are walking together with the little flock on the same narrow path of salvation. Here we see that Elijah had a special power with which Elisha did not have, but later received a double portion of it. This is what we read in 2 Kings chapter 2, that this event happened as they both talked and walked together. This takes place while both knew that Elijah would be taken by the Lord. Even so, this represents the condition where the little flock as well as the great multitude know very well that their salvation is very near, that their redemption draweth nigh. Look, 21:28. Therefore, we read in 2 Kings 2:1-2 that they both went from Gilgal to Bethel. Gilgal means wheel, rolling, while Bethel means house of God. As God's plan rolled on, the little flock and the great multitude walked together to become the house of the Lord. The development of the church continued. But was the church completed at this moment? Paul thought it was completed. Hence we read in verse 2 that Elijah said unto Elisha, tarry here. Why? To be taken up. But was Elijah taken up? No, he was not taken up. Similarly, the church was still not glorified, and they both stayed together. And we continue to read that Elisha said unto him, as the Lord liveth and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they went down to Bethel. From Bethel, they traveled to Jericho. Jericho means fragrant. The church continued to offer their bodies as a living sacrifice, which was a sweet smelling fragrant to God. But still, it was not glorified. They both went on, verse 4 and 5. From Jericho, they traveled to Jordan. Jordan means descender or judge down. This is where they both were separated. The little flock and the great multitude are separated in the final judgment, dear brethren. Now is the time of the final judgment. For we read in 1 Peter 4:17-19, for the time is come, the judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begins at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous say scarcely be saved, what shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? Wherefore, let them thus suffer according to the will of God, commit the keeping of their soul to him in well-doing as unto a faithful creator. In 2 Kings 2:8, we read that Elijah took his mantle and wrapped it together and smote the waters, and they were divided hither and thither. So they both went on dry ground. Water in the Bible represents people. Revelation 17:15. The mantle which Elijah wore represents the zeal and authority of the truth. For we read in Isaiah 59:17, it says, for he put on righteousness as a breastplate and an helmet of salvation upon his head. And he put on the garments of vengeance for clothing and was clad with a zeal as a cloak. We see that Jesus spoke the truth with authority. In Mark 1:22-27, it says, and they were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one that had authority and not as the scribes. Verse 27. And they were all amazed, in so much they all questioned among themselves, saying, what thing is this? What new doctrine is this? For with authority commandeth he even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. The truth spoken by our Lord was so convincing to his hearers that it was not confusing as the scribes and Pharisees. Jesus smote the Jewish people with this truth, which caused a division among the Jewish people. Hence, Jesus said in Matthew 10, 34 and 35, "Think not that I am come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword. For I am come to set a man at variance against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law." It is the same truth that shall be used by the true church upon the people, which shall cause division among them. It is the veil that shall be poured upon river Euphrates, which shall dry the river and make way for our King Jesus Christ from east, as the Son of Righteousness, to enter Babylon to utterly destroy it. Revelation 16, 12. This is the chariots of fire and horses of fire mentioned in 2 Kings 2, 11. For horses in the Bible means doctrine, while the fiery horses represents the heated doctrine, which causes debate, friction among the various church organizations represented by the chariots. This is what happened during the days of John the Baptist. The antitypical Elijah who lived during the first advent of our Lord. Matthew 17, chapter 12 to 13. "But I say unto you that Elijah is already come, and they knew him not, but have done unto him whatso they listed. Likewise shall also the Son of Man suffer of them. Then the disciples understood that he spoke unto them of John the Baptist." John the Baptist rebuked Herod for marrying his brother Philip's wife, Herodias. Mark 16, chapter, verses 17 to 20. "Though what John spoke was the truth, yet it was very disturbing to Herodias, like a plague, very difficult to digest. Therefore, she even had a quarrel with John the Baptist. Even so, the final witness given by the last faithless saints just before our glorification will be of the same impact. Friction and expression of anger on their part, resulting in the persecution of the church." Jesus gave this as one of the signs of his second presence in Luke 21, verses 12 to 20. But before all this, they shall lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you to the synagogues and into prisons, being brought before kings and rulers for my name's sake. This verse is very clear that in the near future, the religious and the political powers will join hands to put an end for doctrine against Babylon. Loyalty to Christ will bring misunderstanding and persecution. This is the time that as they both went on talking, that there suddenly appeared fiery chariots and fiery horses. The doctrine thus causing friction and arrest. Verse 13, "And it shall turn to you for a testimony. This is the day that the Lord has made to give an open public witness about our one true God, like as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego gave before all the Babylonians and were thrown into the furnace." Even Revelation 10, 11, also tells the same. Thou must prophesy again before many people and nation and tongues and kings. Again means once more for the last and the final time. The media these days are bold and encourages expression of free speech, which is the result of increase of knowledge during the last day. The blessing of pandemic is that all have understood the importance and effectiveness of social media and internet connectivity. These events will be used to propagate and transmit the truth of the divine plan in real time on all social media and reach to the end of the world within no time, thus causing commotion, revolt, friction all around the world. But all seeming evil shall be overruled for the good of the church. Dear brethren, verse 14 and 15, it says, settle it therefore in your hearts, not to meditate before what you shall answer. For I will give you a mouth and wisdom, which all your adversaries shall not be able to gainsay nor resist. That is the time when all our theory will be put to practical test. God will guide us what to speak, what not to speak, for which none can answer. This will cause jealousy, anger, hatred, which will be the cause of persecuting the church unto death. Now verse 16 and 17. You shall be betrayed both by parents and brethren and kinsfolk and friends, and some of you shall they cause to be put to death, and you shall be hated of all men for my name's sake. Seeing the death penalty to the church, many will draw back from the consecration vow and deny even knowing each other, while some betray the brethren, even as Judas betrayed our Lord, all for selfishness, to save their own soul, forgetting our Lord's words, that for whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. Matthew 16:25. Verse 18 and 19 says, but there shall not a hair of your head perish. In your patience possess you your souls. This is the moment that the wise virgins will wait patiently for the scene to move as per his will. Who can overrule all for our good and his wondrous works to perform? This will be the moment of joy rather than fear for the true church, because this will be the gateway to the other side of the veil, where they can rest from their labor. The verse to continue, Revelation 14:13. When this will take place, the anarchy, the great time of trouble will be on its peak. Lot of commotion is happening in political, social, religious, financial fields. When these four winds of heaven are let loose, there will be a great whirlwind. It is in this whirlwind that the little flock will finish their course as martyrs. Just before Elijah was taken, Elisha requested that he be granted a double portion of his spirit. This was a hard thing, but only to be granted upon a condition that he was to see Elijah taken up. This happened as Elisha requested. He saw Elijah being taken up and received the double portion of his spirit. Hence, Elisha did praise the miracles of Elijah. Elisha also received the mantle of Elijah, smote the same river Jordan as did Elijah, and continued his work. Thus, everybody identified that he had received the double portion of the spirit of Elijah. 2 Kings verses 9 to 15. Dear brethren, the mantle and the spirit which Elijah had, Elisha didn't have. The zeal And the spirit of consecration which the little flock have, the great multitude lack. Yet they desire to have it. This lack was fulfilled by Elijah. Similarly, the lack of zeal among the great multitude will be fulfilled by the little flock. How? Upon a condition that they should see the glorification of the little flock. The great multitude, seeing the glorification of the church, will become more zealous and rejoice. These, like the foolish virgins, realize their lack of spirit of consecration, will go to the market to buy the oil from the one who sells it. But it will be too late. The one who is having the storehouse of oil is our Heavenly Father. He doesn't give it free of cost. We need to buy it. We need to spend and be spent. It will cost us even the sacrifice of ourselves. This is the covenant that we made with our Lord, to offer our bodies voluntarily as a living sacrifice pleasing to the Lord. It is only upon this condition that the Lord gives us more of the Holy Spirit that we spend in His service. The master of the storehouse sells it in the marketplace of this world. It is only as we witness and stand for the truth in the world that we get to increase boldness and zeal for the Lord. The little flock develops this character voluntarily day by day in their consecrated walk of life. But the great multitude neglect their consecration vow and develop this only when they are forced to do it. This is the meaning of Elisha doing the same work of Elijah. They both live together, walk and talk side by side, the same narrow way, even as did Elijah and Elisha. The crown is only for them who heed to the Lord's advice. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and sat down with my Father in his throne. Revelation 3:21. We need to overcome even as the Lord overcome voluntarily, dear brethren, not by force. We read in Songs of Solomon, chapter 5, verse 2 and 3, the attitude of the great multitude. When Christ comes to call her, what is she doing? Verse 2 tells, I sleep, but my heart waketh. It is the voice of my beloved that knocketh, saying, open to me, my sister, my love, my dove, my undefiled. See, she is sleeping right well in the world with lots of worldly blessings, dreams, ease, and comfort. Seeing a reaction for the call of the Lord in verse 3. See the reaction in verse 3. I have put off my coat. How shall I put it on? I have washed my feet. How shall I defile them? They have forgotten their consecration vow with the Lord and have kept aside the robe of righteousness and are lazy enough to put on the new man after the image of Christ. They have kept their feet washed and not intended to defile them. They are clean and pure. They have not gone completely to the world. They are not ready to get dirty in the Lord's service. They are virgins who think that just quitting sin is consecration. No, dear brethren. I would like to quote from the Studies in the Scriptures, Volume 6, Study 3, The Call of the New Creation, page 157, under the subheading erroneous views of consecration. Kindly, I request every brethren to kindly read it for yourself, because as the time is very short, I need to take another 5 more minutes, that's all. So that is my allotted time. So I need to finish the discourse within that time. I request everybody to read that point from the 6th volume. Thank you. They say, the reaction of the great multitude, they say, I have washed my feet. How shall I defile them? In the service of the Lord by self-sacrifice. By the time they realized an open up for the beloved had gone. Verse 6, I opened to my beloved and my beloved had withdrawn himself. He was gone. My soul failed. When I spoke, I sought him, but I could not find him. I called him, but he gave me no answer. This will be the reward of the great multitude. They will lose their crown of being a queen to the Lord and reign with him 1,000 years. At last, we see the sons of prophets thinking that Elijah might be still alive, went in search for him, only to realize after 3 days that it was vain. Similarly, the sons of prophets, the many Christians thinking that still the door for the high calling is open, will seek for it, but in vain, will realize only after the Third World War. At last, dear brethren, in 2 Kings 2nd chapter, verses 19 to 22, we read about the first miracle, the healing of the waters of Jericho. This is the first thing that will happen when the visible kingdom be established on earth. The false doctrine shall be healed. The fountain, the source of truth shall be healed. All will be given the pure truth. The living waters flowing from the temple. Dear brethren, let us remember that both are walking and talking together. In the same narrow way, let us not lose heart in putting our efforts to win the crown. May the Lord add his blessings to the understanding of his holy words. I thank once again my Heavenly Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for this opportunity, and the Convention Committee for giving me the opportunity to serve his flock. I also thank the translators, brethren, for translating the Lord's voice in various languages. If anybody has any questions after the question sessions, they can still WhatsApp to me or email to me. I'll be sending the notes via chat, via Zoom. May God bless all till we meet again. Thank you.